Hello friends, welcome back to another episode of Reddit Nuclear Revenge. In this episode, you'll hear about how someone's generosity turned into a fight with a neighbor, how you should never mess with anyone on lawless international waters, and how one trucker got rid of a perverted nuisance. I hope you stay for all the stories today and subscribe for future videos. Don't take advantage of other people's generosity. This story's titled, Lady Wouldn't Vacate Private Parking Space. Good luck finding your licenseless car in another country police impound lot. I lived in an apartment complex in Lisbon, Portugal. The where is important. If anyone's from here, you'll know that parking is hell. Fortunately, my building has a private garage. However, as is often the case, some parking places are more difficult to park in than others. I have one of the easier ones. Last year, I was offered a job abroad and took it. Thought I'd be nice, parked my car at my parents' place where they have plenty of space, and left a note in the building elevator. I'm owner of 3B and will be away for at least 6 months. Feel free to use my parking spot. Ended up being away for longer, almost a year. Came back to see my parking spot occupied, which was okay since I offered for it to be used. Put another notice in the elevator, this time to say that I was back and would use the parking spot again. Gave it 2 days and picked up my car from my parents. I went into my garage and my space was still being used. Had to park it somewhere on the street and decided to give it another day. The day after, it was occupied again by the same car. Asked a couple of neighbors and figured out that it belonged to a lady living 2 stories above me. I went up to talk to her and she immediately got defensive and said that her parking spot is very difficult for her to park in. And since I was away for longer than I had announced, I lost the space. Which is stupid logic, as the spots are bought with the apartment, it literally belongs to me. I went to the building admin, who said he'd talk to her. He did, and came back shaking his head. Nothing. I sent a registered letter, telling her to stop using my space, and giving her 48 hours to take her car elsewhere. The next day, I saw the unopened letter in the garage bin, beside the mailboxes. I ended up scouting my garage, waiting for her to leave, and would immediately park my car, hoping she'd take the hint. She didn't, and we ended up doing this dance for a few weeks. Up until the day I came back to see my entire driver's side door with a long, deep streak from a key. That was the final straw. I talked to a friend who owns a towing company. We chose a Saturday morning and towed her car. The plan initially was to leave the car just down the road, but that felt too close and too easy. Then, I thought about leaving it in a city about 15 minutes away. But it still didn't feel quite right. My friend jokingly said, let's leave it in Madrid. For your information, Madrid is in Spain, about 600 kilometers, which is about 375 miles away. I knew he was joking, but Madrid did feel right. I asked if he had enough time. He had, so off we went. Once we got to Madrid, we went out for lunch, strolled around the city, and waited until it got dark and the streets empty. In the meantime, we had decided on where to leave the car, a handicapped parking spot close to a police station, and so we did. As a bonus, my friend also took both of the license plates off the car, then we drove back home. It's been 2 weeks, and I haven't seen her car since. One of these days, I might leave a letter in her mailbox, telling her to contact Madrid police, but in the meantime, I'll enjoy being able to use my parking spot whenever I want to. Never mess with the quiet guy. This story's titled, Prick of a Boss Was Eliminated During Party. This is a story a colleague told me a few days ago. He's an older fellow who's not shy and quite proud of his labor-intensive work background. My colleague was a seaman in his youth, working on ships from Oceania in Asia to South America, etc. He worked on several ships from different companies and countries, but after he married, he quit the sea and now works as a security guy in some lame office from 9 to 5. This event happened in the 80s in Oceania, where he was working on a fishing ship with a crew of 35 to 45 seamen. About 15 of the seamen were from the same country as him, and the others from neighboring countries as well, but the bosses were from a parent company. Amongst all the bosses, the vice manager is the biggest prick. He has anger issues, repeatedly bullies workers, and even assaulted them from time to time. If a worker wasn't fast enough, he'd often hit them on the head with an ironing tool. All the workers did wear hard hats, but even so, It was also common for this vice manager to fight and smack workers who didn't dare challenge him or even fight back. Again, the workers spoke different languages and were working in the middle of the sea, far from land. After several months at sea, almost everybody on the ship had been harassed by the vice manager, even OP, who's a quiet person who doesn't talk a lot. For some reason, over the last week, however, the vice manager kept messing with OP every chance he got. OP never complained when there was work to do and never failed to do it, which made him liked by the other managers. Vice managers seemed to dislike that a low-level seaman was liked by the other managers and even the captain. During the harassment, the vice manager kept complaining about OP's work, hitting him on the head, cursing, spitting, and trying to start fights. He even accused OP of stealing some cigarettes and ship supplies. That, however, didn't get anywhere, as the captain and other managers sided with OP. This harassment went on until OP finally got to the point where his blood was boiling and he really wanted to smack the vice manager without telling anybody. The revenge. One day, the ship got a big catch, so the whole crew worked hard and called it a day. These ships usually don't work the day after a big catch, as their storage would be full, and everybody had worked hard the day before. Usually, there'd also be a party on the ship, singing, eating, drinking, a lot of drinking, till they drop. This is important later. The vice manager got drunk and started harassing others and saying shit, screaming, etc. But with everybody being drunk, it was nothing weird. OP, however, seeing how drunk the vice manager was getting, decides to hint obviously to the vice manager that he needs to pee outside that night. So he tells everyone that he's going to the loo and heads out to the deck. The vice manager obviously sees him and tries to follow him secretly to the deck so nobody knows. OP knew that the vice manager would follow him, but he acted like he didn't know that he was being followed. So the vice manager would keep following him to the other side of the ship, on the back. When he got to the back rail, OP acted like he was peeing on the deck, when suddenly, the vice manager attacked him from behind with an iron tool. OP saw the attack coming and fought back. Now they were both punching and hitting each other on the deck. One thing important to remember is that OP didn't get drunk at the party like the vice manager did. So, unlike the vice manager, OP still had full use of his abilities, making the fight very one-sided. When OP had beaten the vice manager halfway to the ground, he grabbed the vice manager's shirt and trousers and threw him into the ocean in the middle of the cold night. OP spotted the vice manager's shoes lying on the deck where they had fallen off during the fight and quickly threw them to the ocean too. He returned to his room, panicking, shivering, and tried to sleep it off as the ship kept sailing that night. The next morning, the crew went back to work as normal and OP returned to his work as usual. By 10 a.m., one of the other managers is looking for the vice manager, but can't find him, so he reported him missing to the captain. No one could remember seeing him after the party, and he wasn't in any of the rooms, so the ship was brought to a stop, and the crew was instructed to search for him in every corner. OP even took part, even though he knew that he was never to be found. Everybody was questioned on his whereabouts, except OP, as he was less likely to know, or even have anything to do with him. Especially as he's considered a quiet man. The captain also took an account that everybody was drunk that night, especially the vice manager, as he's known to be a heavy drinker. So the captain assumed that the vice manager must have fallen into the ocean that night on his own, without anybody knowing. The crew continued their work that day, and the captain might have reported to shore about the missing vice manager, but that's it. Don't jerk off at red lights. This story's titled Paintballs. I was a fuel trucker. Say that five times fast. I had a regular daily route in my state and would start just after 4 p.m., so I was refilling the area's gas stations roughly after the evening rush. This had me driving late into the night. In this one small town, it seemed like every night around 10, this douchebag in a T-top would pass me on the road while jerking off. He always seemed to find me, pull up next to me on the highway, and try to get my attention before zipping down the road. One week, I saw him three nights in a row at the same red light. It was the summer, so he had his roof down each time. Then, I got an idea, a wonderful idea. When I got home, I gathered what I needed from my teenage son's room. The next night, as I drove through that small rural town, sure enough, Mr. T-Top pulled up next to me, whacking it and giggling as he looked up at me. noticing that my window was down for the first time. Then, he saw the paintball gun. My son was avid at the sport, and had saved for a very long time to buy this thing, and modify it out for team and league stuff. My point is, it could shoot fast, very fast. And I lit him up. The inside of his car, him and his, lap, were covered in green paint in about 3 seconds. I don't know how long it took him to get in gear and run that red light, but I was empty before he was out of the intersection. Never saw him again. Hey everyone, I hope you enjoyed the stories in this episode. If you want to submit a story, join my Discord server. The link is in the description. If you aren't subscribed, hit the subscribe button and turn on notifications so you don't miss future episodes. See you guys in the next one.